is an estimate for you.
In here.
How are you moving it?
elephants.
Exactly. As I was about to go, good evening and welcome to the Fireside Chats. An elephant just trumpeted and Marc was the first to call. I didn't know what to do, but that was interesting timing. Sorry we're a little bit late this evening, folks, but we had a small issue that, thankfully, with Brian's wisdom, having spent so much time here, we managed to overcome it, and we can carry on with the Fireside Chats as normal. But I guess this is the first time there's going to be all three of us here, so it's not business as normal. So welcome to Brent.
Thank you very much, guys.
Welcome, Brent.
It's a privilege and a pleasure to be here with you guys.
It's great to have you on the team.
Yes, it's been really a breath of fresh air having Brent with us, and Marc and myself are enjoying the extra knowledge and different take on guiding and extra stories that we've all been sharing with one another, so things are going well so far.
I think so, and I think there's that common ground that I think is rather unusual. I've met so many guides over the years, but now suddenly there's three of us that have very similar experiences. I mean, there are not that many people that have had experience in East Africa, and I think there's common ground with the three of us that having spent time in East Africa. That I think that was sort of the thing that broke the ice with us most of all.
Certainly.
Is that when you, what we call the Boerewors curtain, by the way, when you go north, Boerewors, this is Boerewors on the fire, by the way, it's a sausage that we're cooking, and it's very South African, and we call anything north of, I suppose, Zimbabwe, north of the Boerewors curtain. But having said something about East Africa, do you want to just enlighten us about a bit of your past?
Oh, thanks, Al. I've been very, very lucky and privileged in the way I've grown up. My family's been in the wildlife industry since sort of the mid-80s. So I grew up in safari lodges, originally in South Africa, and then we moved up to Botswana and also in Zambia. So I was very lucky to be blessed with lots of really good teachers, trackers, other guides that I met over the years, before I even started my sort of professional guiding career. And then it's been sort of all over the place since then, but in South Africa, in the Sabi Sands, at Singita and Londolozi, and then up north to Tanzania with Great Plains, in the Southern Salu, which is a fascinating part of the world. And then the last sort of big adventure was into the Central African rainforest, which was, it was like starting all over again. You had to literally learn new trees, new animals. It was an incredible experience.
I think I envy him that.
Certainly, I certainly do. He's been telling me about the photos and videos he's got, and I'm just stalling it as much as I can. I'm not sure if I'm ready for taking a look at the adventures that he had up in Central Africa.
Do you think it's going to prompt you to pack your bags? And I'm thinking that. I was talking to Brent, and I was learning about so many different types of dacre, so many different types of bush babies. But you haven't even started. You haven't even got to the insects and the spiders.
And the spiders and the snakes.
And the snakes.
And the fish species.
And the fish.
Yeah, that's incredible.
But we did. You touched a little bit on the snakes and things. Like the Gabon viper and the rhino viper.
Yeah, Goldie's tree cobras and all sorts of
And that interesting
things.
Boa, that interesting no, member the, of the python
a,
family.
A calabar boa. It's a blind boa. And I mean, you only see them after really heavy rains when they're pushed out of the earth, like our blind snakes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But they're incredible. They tie themselves into a knot that's around your hand, and it's really difficult to get them off once you. So it's a very interesting species.
There was a type of boa, and I'm not too sure it's the same, and I wish I had my East Africa reptile book. Have you seen that East African reptile book?
I think I have.
Stephen. I haven't seen it in any other reptile. None of the South African books. But it's a member of the python and boa family that I found up in Kenya in the Chulu Hills one day on a walk, funnily enough. And it sounds kind of similar.
Yeah. I think they do, as far as I know, they do occur in East Africa, but I thought only Aberdare, sort of Mount Kenya in the more wet areas.
Sounds like more forested, montane and forest. But I'm wondering if it's not the same. You know, I've always only believed we have three pythons in Africa. We've got the African rock python, the dwarf python, and then there's the... What is it called? Also, ball python.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know of any other pythons?
Not actual pythons, but python sort of family, sort of the boas, the constrictors that related to, but not actually sort of pythons.
I mean, if you look at the brown half snake and the Cape wolf snake, they're both similar in that they've got the shape, that python shape. But this particular snake was also fossorial, ground dwelling or subterranean. Only managed to find it by pure luck. And it wasn't very long. It was maybe 2 feet long. But it was like a miniature python, but maybe it's the coloration. Maybe we need to look at pictures.
No, definitely. I think it's a good mission for us when we get home. Whip out the reptile box.
But then there's the other side of living in that kind of a forest environment.
Yeah, well, there are more bugs than I've ever seen in my life, and I probably got bitten by more tsetse flies, mosquitoes, leeches, and the worst things are filaria flies or knuckle flies. When you're walking through the forest, they're horse flies that sort of just manage to get you between your knuckles every single time. But I think for me, definitely the worst thing is we call them invisibles. Mm. In French, they call them farou.
In North America, they call them no-see-ums.
No-see-ums, exactly. They're tiny midges that you can't see, and they come out at dusk and dawn, and they can literally cover your whole body. And in a place that's really hot and humid, sort of force you to wear long-sleeve clothing and long pants, stitches. And I thought I'd get used to the bugs after a while. The bugs were the biggest challenge. And eating out of tins.
Yeah. Oh, yes. That I would imagine. I remember experiencing no-see-ums in Baja, Mexico. Actually, on the Sea of Cortez, funny enough. Most beautiful beach settings. Camping on this beach with the most beautiful blue waters. And there were these islands just off the coast that had blue-footed boobies. The most wonderful bird life. And I can only imagine the marine life that lived there. I never got to dive there, sadly. But we were so inundated with no-see-ums that Sandy actually got sick. She got, it was my girlfriend at the time, she actually got physically debilitated from it all.
And was there a relatively quick and easy cure?
No, it was just sleeping for a couple of days. All she could do
fatigue.
Was just
never give you a chance to rest, basically. Mm. We were lucky, we only had them sort of for the first hour around sunrise and the first hour around sunset. And it's only when we're in the river areas. When we're on the beach, the wind was strong enough that it kept them away.
But even mosquito nets, they're so small, they go through mosquito nets.
They can go through the mesh in your tent if you don't close the sort of rain fly.
So as you say, hot and humid, where you want air movement
and you've got to close it all up. Closed in, yeah.
Okay, well, learn to sleep in the sauna, I guess.
Okay, well, for those viewers who are new to the Fireside Chatters, a lot of you may be, it is just like the drives that we hold. It is interactive. So if you'd like to ask any of us a question directly, you can address it to whoever you'd like to answer the question, or you could send through a question that any of us could answer or we could answer collectively. And to do that, you would hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions@wildearth.tv. And Alex, who's in the final control, who I'm sure already has a lot of questions building up, will try and get as many of those through to us as possible, and then we'll be able to answer some of your questions, as well as also just recap on some of the interesting things that we've been seeing over the last few weeks, hearing some more of Brent and Mark's tales from abroad.
And yours.
And mine. So do feel free to send through those questions, and we can get to answer some of them. The nice thing about the campfire chats is that the questions that you ask may not necessarily be linked to what we may be viewing like we would like to do on the drives. So on drives, we tend to try and field the questions that are relative to what we're seeing or what's going on, whereas the campfire chat allows for kind of more vague questions or any interesting questions that you may be thinking of that haven't been answered along the drives. Alex, do you have any questions for us?
Well, I'm hoping that you guys are going to be able to catch up on a lot of what we've been seeing over the past. And part of the whole thing of us being here is to be able to... Ooh, guess what's...
Oh, tiny little beetle.
No.
The stink bug.
It's one of those almond bugs that only come in with the storm. But one of the things that drives us, and one of the things that is sort of the core of what we do here is following certain individual animals and being part of the lives of certain animals, and hoping that you're going to be able to, both of you actually. Scotty is already, having been here for a couple of months, is already familiar with some of our regulars, is familiar with some of our local animals. what we like to do is follow those animals who are so territorial that we tend to live within their territories. And we might not see them every day, we might not be with them every day, but it's nice to catch up with them from time to time. But it's also what is really fantastic about all of that is that we rely on you, the viewers, to help us identify them. And it's not to say that we can't, it's that that's just a really important facet to our interactive broadcasts that we do.
Good. Well, sorry, I haven't been focusing on you guys. I've been focusing on the question coming through. But we've got a question through from Reisa in Finland for Brent. And you mentioned briefly that yourself and your mother hand-raised some animals while you were growing up. So if you could enlighten us on one or two of those, or let us know what the circumstances were behind those.
Good evening, Reisa. Well, I guarantee you it's a lot warmer where we're sitting now than home in Finland. But especially while we were younger, my mom was involved with the Natal Parks Board as a sort of, and my dad knew a lot of people in that area. So they would get animals brought in, and because we lived out in a farm in a wilderness area, that they would sort of give us animals to look after, to see if we could try and release them back into the wild. So we had quite a lot of interesting things. We had quite a few grey duiker, most of them were eventually successfully released. They eventually just sort of wandered out of the garden and onto the farm. But probably the most fun pets we had were the mongooses. So the last one we had, his name was Lord Montague, and he literally ran the household. But the one thing that's quite funny about them and is very disconcerting for visitors, because he's a male, mongooses do a lot of scent marking with their anal pouch. And so a new person would walk into the house, and the mongoose would come plump straight on their foot, and scent mark all over their foot, which with people who are not used to animals, and that can give them quite a fright. Is the mongoose wiping his bum on their feet. We also had a jennet, which was also quite a nice one. She used to sleep in the sock drawer. And then we had black eagles, various birds and owls, warthog. We had an impala named Biltong, and another impala named Potroast.
I know of a warthog that was named Christmas.
And unfortunately, with Biltong and Potroast, when they got old and started leaving the house at Pinda and joining the impala, both got eaten by cheetah. But that's nature. So, it was a very interesting childhood having those type of animals. And that was much when I was much younger. And when you moved to Botswana, the nature of the bush there, you don't have so many hand-ins and stuff because it's a much bigger natural system. And from then, we didn't really have any wild pets, per se.
Did you have any? Did you grow up with any?
No, I just had a few domesticated pets. Yeah. Although snakes and scorpions that I caught along the way were good. Yeah. So other than that, no wild animals growing up. Sadly, my city upbringing didn't allow for the same adventures that Brent had in his upbringing. But that's really interesting.
I had tropical fish and terrapins and newts and snakes and spiders and scorpions, all sorts of things that I could find. And of course, all the stray dogs and stray cats that came across my path would always come home with me. And my sisters, we always were bringing animals home to Mom. And what we thought we were bringing them home for us, but Mom ended up looking after them.
That's always the case, isn't it? I promise, Mom, I'll clean it, wash it, feed it every day. But, Mom, I'm tired.
Very often they'd be handed off to very good homes, but there were the few that would stick. But I've never been lucky enough to... Well, no, I don't know where... You know what?
It's a difficult one.
It is. I don't know if it's a lucky thing or not. It's a sad thing. I have raised... Since my childhood, I've tried to raise animals. I've been involved in other animals being raised. My biggest disappointment was raising woodland kingfishers. And one died probably about 2 weeks after I got them. And I got them both when they were tiny little things. And I would feed them insects every night. And one died, and the one that remained actually managed to learn how to fly, and they would sit around the trees around the staff quarters while we were out on drive, and he'd come back to me in the evenings.
I think it's just a vehicle.
Yeah, a minute I thought it was Ellie. But that, by the way, that sounded like elephants up there on Zoe. Missed elephants today. Anyways, this one kingfisher that was left, it got to be where he was flying, and he would follow me anywhere, and he would fly out of the trees and land on my shoulder. But it was an incredible relationship until the one day that a goshawk took him right in front of me. And that is the sadness and the reality of raising pets. As you say, and raising impala that you get close to, no doubt, because you feed
them behind the ear.
Yes.
And seeing a goshawk make a call is probably something you've always wished of seeing, but not in this time.
No. Especially because it didn't kill the kingfisher. His name was Kez. And it didn't kill the child. It grabbed it and flew away. And there was this kingfisher calling me the way it would normally call to me when it's hungry, but a little bit more intense. As this goshawk was flying away with this kingfisher in its talons, this kingfisher screaming for my attention, and I'm sort of, can't do anything about it. But I suppose it's just a lesson that we learn, is that wild animals, for the most part, should probably be left alone, unless there's a very good chance of rehabilitating them and
releasing them
into the wild where they are conscious enough or learned enough, they've experienced enough. Being in captivity, it might not even be captivity, but just under human care, that they can look after themselves and fend for themselves. Because invariably, as humans, we can't teach them the dangers. We can't teach them how to react. We are just human, after all. Ill-equipped. Very much so.
But yeah, like you say, it's something that's a privilege for a very select few to grow up having that experience where you can raise wild animals, but it's not something you would
encourage.
Like you say, it's a very, very difficult.
Very much so. I can't imagine I can't mention how many people want to have a bush baby or a genet or something as a pet because they think it's so cute. But what they don't realize is that there's certain things that are going to change their lives dramatically. And first of all, it is the nature of an animal, especially like a genet or a bush baby, which tends to be nocturnal. You've had a genet. My sister...
jump on you while you're sleeping.
when they were at Itala, my brother-in-law was warden, western sector of Itala, and they raised a genet. And they never got any sleep, because when they wanted to sleep, the genet was awake. And they were the family, so why can't you play with me? It's not time for sleeping now.
Mm.
But also bush babies, another thing, that being nocturnal, but they also have this habit of urinating everywhere. Their method of marking their territory, urinating on their hands and feet and wiping it everywhere. Much like you say with that mongoose. You know, a lot of people are not prepared for all of that, but the most important that we're not prepared for is falling in love with these animals and then losing them to predators.
Mm-hmm.
Because we can't take care of
them. And it's almost, it's not an if, it's a when.
Exactly. It is, pretty much. For a lot of creatures, it's wonderful to raise them and sort of take in those orphans, but for the most part, when they are taken in and they are raised by humans, if you want them to survive, they've got to stay in human company for the rest of their lives. And that's not really possible.
No.
Yeah.
Well, it's unfair, especially for social animals, things that should be within herds or groups or family groups.
One of the most difficult things about the mongoose, because it was abandoned mongoose. It's such a social animal.
Yeah.
Okay, well, Risa, thanks very much for that question that you opened up to us there, because it was a good discussion that was had and one that could go on for days. So, Alex, when you're ready, you can send through the next one.
How's Anyamma doing?
Ah, it's looking good.
It is.
Yeah, got some chops and some vores. So they cook slowly.
Yeah. And we might even get some hyena coming in.
If it smells that good.
If it smells that good.
No, I got the spotlight here to double check. Nothing. Do you know that sneaks up on us.
We've had fireside chat here with leopard.
Oh, Scott was telling me, sitting in the tree. Yeah.
Were you here for that?
I was here, it was the most incredible experience to be a part of.
Peter and Hayden sitting here with fireside chat, and there's a leopard in the tree back there. And we had our last fireside chat, I don't know if you know that, but the fireside chat that we had at that last one, and then you left, there was zebra behind us for a lot of the fireside chat.
Oh no, we didn't know.
we didn't even know about it.
Yeah, Brian and VM pulled the sneaky one on us there and thought they would let us... missed the opportunity to call in the zebra, but all the viewers must have enjoyed seeing that. Anyway, Brent's got another question from Kathleen in New York, and she's asking whether the animal reintroduction program that you're involved in with your dad ever got broadcasted as a documentary, or there was ever anything made into that.
Good evening, Kathleen. It's a bit more complicated. I'm not 100% sure what you're speaking about there, but I presume you're talking about the founding of the Pinda Game Reserve. As such, it wasn't documented as a documentary, but it would have been a really interesting story. Dad started and we took over cattle farms and then slowly bought up the surrounding farms and then reintroduced elephant for the first time in 100 years, lion, cheetah, and rhino, and all the wildlife, and even buffalo that had been removed from that by people over the years. And I mean, and Pinda now is a world-famous reserve that's very, very well-known, and you can go see lions hunting and whatnot. But that was the first lions in that part of Zululand recorded in over 110 years when they reintroduced into that area. So I think there were some stories done on it, but more news pieces, not an actual documentary.
Weren't some of those lions from the Sabi Sand?
They were actually from north of Hoedspruit, some of them.
Okay.
Then I think later on, I think the second group that were brought in to help with genetics were definitely from Sabi Sand. I think they might have even been from around Londos.
And I also heard there were some of them that came in from Namibia.
That's much later. I know that they were working on, speaking of lions... Far away.
The Matimbas are quite far south.
Yeah, it just sounded like the end of it in the distance there.
I missed it, sadly. But I'm out of practice. I've been in the city too long. My bush ears are not back to full strength.
You'll get back.
But so, with a lot of these reserves that are fenced and not open like we are to Kruger, they have to really watch their genetic variation. So they do bring animals from Namibia, from Sabi Sands, and they'll actually remove males just to keep the genetics strong so they don't get inbred.
Inbred, yeah.
We're lucky where we're sitting now because we open to 2.4 million hectare system. That isn't such an issue.
No. It wasn't. There was... Well, I mean, I'm familiar with, and a lot of the viewers are familiar with Thorny Bush, which has a very close population of lion, which is what Brent's talking about, that there is management that is needed of the population because you can't let them just continue to breed. And it becomes quite a sticky subject, whether you're going to introduce new genes or whether you're going to introduce contraception, allowing them to breed. I think what was happening in Thorny Bush, though, it was one lucky thing, is that it was a male from Timbervati.
He broke through the fence. Yeah, and he taught the Thorny Bush lions how to hunt buffalo. They literally didn't hunt buffalo till he arrived.
Oh.
And then they just started whacking buffalo.
Really?
No, it was very strange.
That must have been just after we were there then, 2 years ago.
Yeah, he came. I came through. I was on a safari in Thorny Bush. I've been three in the last sort of year now. And literally I had been going there on and off for 5 years. And I'd seen maybe one buffalo kill the sub-adult. But then since this guy... Him and another young male, they're just almost specialized.
Red Dam. No, what was his name?
Black Dam.
Black Dam, yeah, the Black Dam male. That young male that we used to see. In fact, I think one of the first times when I was there, one of our first sightings of him, it was along the fence line of Thorny Bush, just above the Timbervati River, when that big male had just come in from the Timbervati.
Marvin.
And there was, what, Mahogany?
Marvin was his name.
No.
Not Marvin.
No. There was this. Marvin took over that pride in the north.
Oh, okay.
This was another male that came in and he formed a coalition with that young Red Dam.
Oh, yes, Black Dam male. Black Dam. That's the Timbervati male, you call them.
Timbervati. But there was a fight that day. It could have been with Marvin. We didn't really get to see Marvin. We heard a lot about this Marvin. Really scraggly, scratched
up. He's not the best looking.
Well, but then you must know if he's not so good looking. He's been through a lot.
A lot of fights.
Marcus.
But we found him the one day after a bit of a fight with a cut on his lip. And so it made it so easy to identify him. Because he now still carries that scar on his lip from the very first day we saw him. Interesting, though, that the smaller a place is and the more confined it is, the more intense management has to be to control their population. I suppose the smallest of all is sort of a zoo. And so when you look at a zoo, those animals can never really be rehabilitated into the wild. Not never, but not likely. Then so they will always be destined to become the new genes for other zoo stock.
Yeah. Which in some ways is possibly a positive that they're not taking from the wild.
I think from that point of view, very important. So that you get lion like Thorny Bush or other closed in areas where you're able to take maybe lions out of that area and put them into another closed in area, maybe swap.
I know they've swapped the reserve my parents live in, yeah. The Blue Canyon. They swapped male for a female.
Yeah.
That's sodden you pride. So yeah. Black Dam's brother was moved across to Blue Canyon.
Brent's talking about Blue Canyon, which is a place where a few years ago, in fact, probably about 5 years ago, nearly 4.5 years ago, we had a camera on a wild dog den, much like we have the cameras here at Juma Waterhole and at Arethusa, where, although in those days we didn't have Zoomies operating them, yours truly was doing, until we hired a couple of students. But we had 24 hours of wild dog den.
Really?
The day we went live with that wild dog den camera, the pups came out of the den for the first time. I mean, we'd been monitoring it for a while because the camera had been set up. We knew the dogs had chosen that den. And it's testament to how sensitive the whole setup was that we managed to get this trailer with solar panels and all the batteries and all the equipment moved in there very quietly, get the camera set up where it could pan and tilt and zoom and cover most of the den. And then on the day we decided we were going to go live, hoping that there was going to be at least an adult, at least a wild dog, boom, the pups came out of the den for the first time. So needless to say, we didn't go to bed that night. Amazing footage, though. It was amazing things. Up until that point, I never thought that dogs hunted much at night. But you know what they do? Especially when they're denning to bring food back for the pups and that. Out, they would come back, regurgitate meat and then go off again. It was constant back
really,
and forth. Full moon, no moon, didn't really matter. It was amazing activity.
And any interaction of other predators coming into the den?
If I remember correctly, it was quite weird. It was a big warthog boar that came in one day.
That's an interesting predator.
Sorry, predators.
No, but still.
I can't remember other predators.
But what happened with the warthog?
Nothing.
Did he go into one of the... I think he tried.
The viewers are going to have to help me out on
okay.
that. You know, I'm getting old now. My memory is not older.
But do you think possibly because the Blue Canyon's got a very low predator density in terms of other predators, low spotted hyena, slow lion, could be the reason they hunted more
very much so. I think very much so because they were able to... They could be active at night without... I mean, there were no lion then.
I see. So I suppose now that there's lion and there's a nice kind of spotted hyena, the dynamic might change a bit.
I don't think we had any of them come by. I think, yes, there was jackal. If I remember correctly, there were jackal that came past in. But there weren't any other predators in Blue Canyon at the time. I think Blue Canyon is still fairly new.
No, it's only about 7 years old.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they were still restocking it. Now, this restocking that we're talking about, something that Brent mentioned, is... land that has been used for farming and agriculture in the past, where wildlife had pretty much been wiped out for a monoculture or a simple agricultural farming project. Areas that have been proven that they, as wildlife areas and as photographic safari areas can be far more productive, not only in monetary terms, but in land use terms, as wildlife areas than any form of farming and agriculture. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the reasons why we've had in the last, I'd say, 20-odd years or so many new game reserves forming, so many new reserves. Well, I suppose Pinda's a bit more than 20. Pinda's probably about 25 years old by now.
The development started in about 1984, 85.
Okay, guys. Well, Alex says we've got a lot of questions coming through, so let's try and answer a few more quickly.
I'm ready when you are,
Alex.
I think meat's going to be very good.
I think so. I'm starting to get hungry. I'm drooling.
I can smell it as it wafts.
Okay, well, just a quick update on the Juma camera. A lot of people are asking for updates on how it's going, the fixing of it, and it's in the repair shop at the moment. It could be anywhere from a week to 2 weeks that it's back up and running, so apologies for that, but it's being fixed and we'll be getting it back up and running as soon as possible. So that's a message from Alex. And ready for the next question, Alex?
Scops. I've heard a lot of pearlies today.
And when I was sitting at
okay, well, camp. What's being cooked on the fire? The chef we've employed tonight is, as you know, Brent, and he's a professional braai master. Now, braaiing is something that is taken very, very seriously in South Africa, and it's almost a test that Marc and I have for him. If he doesn't pass the test, he's going to have to walk home.
I think so.
and on was it Saturday or Friday night, Scott produced, and Marc actually, produced one of the most elaborate and large braais I've seen for a while. So hopefully I'll do pass the test.
So we showed him how we want it to be done, and now this is his test. And the term that we use, braai, is essentially the barbecue. It just means to cook over the flames. And I believe Brent has got some lamb chops and some boerewors, which is a beef
little
sausage.
Lamb steaks, actually.
Yeah, So two different kinds of meats, a beef sausage and a lamb steak or lamb chop.
Chops without the bone.
Some small bones in them, I think it might be.
Are they?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll have chicken breast when I get home.
Are you having ostrich?
Okay, well, I've just got another question that's come through from Tom in Michigan. Good evening, Tom. And Tom is asking if we know the whereabouts of Kunyuma and, Quarantine, which is the two-year-old, just over 2 years old now. What would it be, 2 years and two
almost
months?
Going on 2.5. I mean, April probably beat, because I think it was about November maybe that she used to give birth.
Okay.
November, early December. All right, so 2.25.
Yeah, so just over 2 years of age are the two male leopards that we followed quite a lot over the last 3.5-4 months, and probably provided more leopard viewing than any other leopard that we do see. So... And we haven't seen them for a while, Mark.
No, they've been so. They've mostly been on Little Gari, and Chitwa, which is almost like where their grandmother's territory was when I arrived here 6 years ago.
Okay. But sadly, no sign of them. We were all hoping to find some of their tracks today because we got a message on the radios yesterday that they'd finished off a kill to the south of us, and interestingly enough, they were both feeding on the same kill together.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Apologies, I should have told you guys, and I forgot about that until now.
Okay.
I'm in trouble.
2 points deducted.
So, instead of me updating Marc and Brent, as I should have, I forgot to completely, and I've just remembered that now, but they weren't very far south of our southern boundary, and they had finished off a kill. I can't remember if the guide told me what they had managed to kill, but whatever that they had, it's very interesting that they are moving together and still feeding on the same kills together, because that won't go on forever.
No.
So, still great that there is a chance to see them together. And I did speak about it the other day on Drive, that it would really be wonderful if we could see Karula, their mother, and the two of them together, because that would be three fully grown leopards, the two sons both bigger than their mother, and a really unique sighting that doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. So that's something to...
I think so.
To hope for.
At least we had Karula came back for a little brief visit just recently.
Yeah.
I thought I saw something flying onto your back, but it's not. That would be interesting. We were lucky enough to have Karula and Mvula, which are the two parents of the leopard that Scott's talking about, the two boys. And sadly, of course, for those of you who haven't been with us for much, for very long, the mother of the two boys that Scott's talking about, Karula, she's known as the Queen of Juma, and she did give birth again last year, November, December, sometime probably in December, I think, based on the age of the cub when we saw it. But it was a very unfortunate thing that the day that we did find her, after not seeing her for some time and speculating as to where she was, she had been seen on a reserve on one of the lodges further east from us, and on a particular day that she did come back onto Western Gari, onto Juma, we followed her, and quite remarkably arrived at it's hard to call it a den, but a spot where she had hidden the cub, and we had just got a glimpse of that cub, for a fraction of a second, it was a few seconds of glimpse, when two hyena came in and unfortunately killed a cub. It was like a freak. It was like a plane falling out of the sky. No, that's a bad analogy, but it
but it was incredibly bad timing, because the jubilation of seeing this cub that everyone knew of for the first time to be just crushed by that tragic event. But it does happen out here, Mark, so that, you know.
But that does.
It's nature. I'm just really excited to see my first leopard since being back in the zombie sands. It's been a while since I've seen a leopard here.
Tomorrow morning.
Hopefully.
Tomorrow morning.
And, I mean, we've tracked and tracked and we found tracks on the first couple of drives, and We just haven't been.
It also took me a while to break the leopard ice, but once you do, it's open gates.
You were on fire when you just before you left.
It was unfair how lucky I was getting. It was certainly unfair how lucky I was getting with bumping into the leopard. But it goes like that.
So, it does. It.
We all know we're going to have our lucky streaks and our tougher moments out there.
And every day you come back from drive and you haven't seen a leopard, you think, the next one, it's going
to
happen.
It has to happen. It's we're building now the pressure. It's like, we're going to a point, we've been on how many drives and not found a leopard. It has to happen now.
I think so.
And then, interestingly, talking about the more recent litter that she lost, hopefully she'll be giving birth to another one very shortly.
I don't think there have been any reports of her.
She hasn't mated after.
She hasn't been seen mating, but I've followed tracks that could well have been hers with a male days after.
Only days
after? Well, like 3 or 4 days after.
It might have been too soon. But he was there.
Mm.
In fact, even both the boys were there as well, because they had those kills in the big jackalberry and down in the drainage line. Now, I think that would have been too soon, to be honest.
Well, I mean, she disappears. I mean, if she went up north or north towards Manileti, you never know.
Yeah.
Well, I suppose, look, what we need to do is we need to find out from our viewers this previous sighting of Karula now, the gap between the sighting before that. How long has that been? Because that might be enough time for her to have been in Eastris, to have been mating elsewhere, Wibblezook or to the east of us, and that she's now carrying. But interestingly that you mentioned it would be really nice to see her with the two boys, is that now it's possible.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe more so now that she doesn't have cubs.
Yeah.
Well, having said that, when we did have her with her, when she was with her third litter as little ones, she would allow her previous litter, the boys of her previous litter. It was a wonderful moment one day up on Triple M, the termite mound. Her son and Duna from her second litter, who was then just over 2 years old, probably around the same time of the year, in fact, so almost the same age as the two boys are now, was lying on the termite mound. Karula was with her two new cubs, which were Shivinzi and Shivambalana. And this little Shivinzi, this little girl, because it was a male and a female, slowly sort of crept up. It wasn't a very high termite mound. Slowly crept up the termite mound and tapped her older brother on the nose. And he didn't really react very much. He hissed a subtle hiss, but other than that, there wasn't
slight raising of the lip.
Yeah.
And Mark, any of her previous litters, do you know where they are? They're about in the area?
Tundi and Saseka, or Shadow. I think Shadow was Tundi and Saseka was Tingana. But there was a lot of confusion because they were named by Wild Earth guys, but they were also named by the Sabi Sand. It was only one of those times when the Sabi Sand guys had their own names for them, but for some reason they were named by Wild Earth guides. But I think the names that stick now are Shadow and Tundi.
Okay.
Tundi was seen this morning, if I'm not mistaken. I might have mentioned it on drive. You know, you know what it's like.
It's
these breaks that we have in between drives are almost like they don't exist, because you get back into the vehicle and you're out there on drive and you want that to continue from your last drive. So to sometimes to separate one incident from all of that and to say, well, that happened on that particular drive. But I think it might have been this morning, Tundi.
Okay.
Shadow, of course, is that leopard that they see Arethusa. On Arethusa all the time. And that's her first litter.
Yeah.
The two females. Her second litter was Mishu and Induna, the two males.
Okay.
I have no idea what happened to them. As far as I know, I think Mishu went up north into Manyaleti, and Induna, I'm not even sure where Induna went to.
So there are still two females that, you know,
her two daughters have now got there. Unfortunately, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the one daughter, Tandy, has lost her cubs. Might have lost her cubs. Shadow's only got one cub left.
Mm-hmm.
But this is the thing, is that we get to follow the lives of wild leopards. Where else do you get to do that? And we've got a camera on the vehicle. We can share it with the world. It's probably one of the most fantastic things in our careers that we could ever do.
100%.
And in real time.
And in real time.
And in real time.
And have our viewers, have all of you out there being able to interact with us, being able to ask us questions, to give us feedback. Because I think you can keep track of the leopards a lot better than we can. That's for sure. Because we move around a lot, and a lot of you are in touch with a lot of the guides from the different lodges.
Okay, well, some viewers, thank you very much. You've just got back to your question, Marc, asking whether or when last Karula was seen. And I think the last time was on Valentine's Day. Alex, if you could just confirm that.
Yeah, that was the recent time. It was just last, 2 weeks ago.
Valentine's, yep.
Okay. So it's been two-week gaps, I think, between her last sightings. And it could well have been. I mean, we also had a few big gaps before we even finished on the 31st of January with,
yes, we did,
that initial production. We hadn't seen her for a few weeks.
2 week gaps are interesting, though,
mm-hmm,
because that's Easter's cycle, and then maybe because this isn't really the core of her territory anymore as the way it used to be, and that's evidenced by the fact that she's not really spending time here. She's only coming this way to mark territory and to do things. Since the cub died, could be that what she's doing now is that she hasn't conceived yet, and every couple of weeks she comes by to mark her territory, hoping that Mvula or another male is going to pick up her Easter scent and join up with her.
Yeah, it's interesting that she has spent so little time here. It's not that we're not finding her, because we're not even seeing tracks. So It's really interesting that we've seen so little of her, considering how much, you know, the fact that she's been named the Queen of Juma. But it is understandable that territories do change.
How old is Karula?
She's 11. In fact, in a week, I think in about a week's time, she'll be 11. March 2004 was when she was born.
Yeah, and there's no pressure coming from another female, because it's not like we're seeing another female.
No. But also, she was seen right from the beginning. I mean, the viewers even knew her mother. Mother was a leopard by the name of Safari. You might have heard of Safari.
Vaguely, yeah. You heard the guys in the north talk about her.
Yes. A very big female. She had only one eye. She had a fight, I think it was her son. I can't remember. Once again, viewers are going to have to help me out there. My memory doesn't serve me correctly. But Safari, her eye, one of her eyes was permanently open and completely damaged and opaque.
Interesting. Mm. Well, there's one more question for Brent, and we might be able to squeeze in another one before we close off. But the question, I can't remember who it's come through from, but I'll go ahead with the question in the meantime, and Alex can remind me of who it's from. Oh, Linda from Texas. Good evening, Linda.
Hot Texas.
And she's asking whether you can let us know a little about the forest elephants that you saw up in Gabon, and how they related, or are they related to African elephants? Where do they fit in relative to the regular elephants we see out here?
Hi, Linda. Thanks very much. It's quite a good question. The forest elephants were long considered to be a separate species, but now with current genetic work, they're actually thought to just be a sort of a local variation of the sort of Loxodonta. But the Latin name for them is actually quite funny, because that's a Loxodonta africana nano, so a mini version of a normal elephant.
That's awesome.
Physical appearance, they're quite different. I mean, a big Ellie bull there will probably, a really big bull will be the size of a cow here, sort of 2.5 to 3 tons. But they do have, in the area I was, still really impressive ivory. We had a couple of elephant bulls whose tusks would actually drag on the ground when he was tired, or especially when he was walking on the beach in the sand. Sort of his tusk, the tip of the tusk would just catch the sand. But physically, their eyes are quite different. They've got a really golden eye. The ears are much smaller. Their head shape is also much, much more rounded, even more rounded than our bulls. And just the body size is the thing that's probably the most apparent when you see them. Also, they don't seem, their eyesight seems to be not nearly as good as the sort of savannah elephants. I think that's probably just they don't use it as much because the forest can be very dark. I mean, in the middle of the day, sometimes you feel like you need to put on a torch because you've got the big storm over the top and a thick tree cover. I'm just trying to think. The family groups, much, much smaller. You very seldom have very big groups of forest elephants together. The only time they really do that is on the byes, which are quite few and far between. They're not that many byes. So you generally find maximum of 4 or 5. Okay. They don't sort of get 20, 30. Mm. Well, in the year I was there, I never saw a group of more than 6 or 7.
Yeah.
And then also in the literature I read about them, they never really get to those big groups.
I think if you can elaborate, though, because I know what a bye is, but...
A bye is basically an opening in the forest. In the Pygmies from the Congo, bye means opening in the forest. And there's generally a water source there with high mineral content, so it attracts gorillas, elephants, bongos, sitatunga, forest hogs, all to come feed on this sort of grass and reeds and drink the water that's got a very high mineral salt content. Thanks very much.
Good
for that
stuff. Yeah. Good stuff there, Brent. Well, we've just got a few more minutes left, so, and I'm having a look at Brent's meat, which is looking delicious. So far, he has looked like he's passed the test, so looking forward to getting stuck into a little bit of that later. But just to start wrapping up, a big thank you for joining us at the Fireside Chat this evening, and great to have Brent alongside us for the first time, and great for myself and Marc to be back here. It's yes. been weeks since it's happened. I think the last one we did was the one that was together.
End of January.
Yeah. So
that amazing time we had here with the elephants in the open air.
Yeah. That's going to be a hard afternoon to beat.
To match, yeah.
So a big thank you from all of us. And just to let you know, if you are interested in tuning in for the AM drive tomorrow, it'll be myself and Brent out searching for leopard.
Pressure's on.
And everything else, but as you heard, Brent has still yet to break the ice of finding a leopard in this area of the Sabi Sands yet. And Marc will have the morning off, so sadly he won't be out with us, but he'll be out again in the afternoon, so you can join him on the PM drive, along with Brent, when I'll be off. Anyway, sorry, Marc.
No, I was just going to say, this is... I think a lot of people have probably figured that out already by now, but having three of us here, we're rotating two drives on, one drive off, and it's working out very, very well. I think we're falling into a really nice, smooth operation of things. Until, of course, comes end of the week, I'm taking a few days off. It's going to disrupt things again.
But that's what keeps us out of mischief, Marc. We've got to be kept on our toes and keep mixing things up.
And that's, indeed.
And that's what we enjoy out here, and that's one of the greatest things about working out in the bush is that... especially on a production like this where there's so many variables and so much equipment and so many things that could potentially go wrong, it keeps us on our toes, and there's a lot of problem solving in between and action. Routine is a word that doesn't really come into place out here. So it's just about 2 minutes left. Brent, anything from your side?
Well, I'd like to thank you, Scott, for having to deal with the earpiece and the questions. You know how difficult it can be. And just that I'm really, really excited to have joined the team and be working with two great guys like Marc and Scott. And, of course, Alex and Brian and Andrew and Graham and everyone else in the team. Everyone's made me feel really welcome, and I'm really excited to see where the future leads us.
It is an exciting project to be a board of, and Brent actually called me before he came in for his first drives and asked me what I thought about the whole operation, and I told him exactly what it is, that unless he's got something very, very important that he needs to do in the next few days, he should certainly come and get involved here. And he did, and I watched some footage from his first drives, and he did a great job from the get-go, so I'm happy it's all worked out so well for him. And who would have thought back in high school days that he would have been sitting here doing this one day?
Wait a minute, you were at high school together?
Yeah, we were 2 years apart.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so Brent's slightly wiser and older than me, but only very slightly.
Learn something new every day.
Well, there's just a minute left, so... okay, yes, and a big apology for not getting through all the questions. It's something that we are trying to fine-tune and work out how we can answer more of your questions at the Fireside Chat. But
And
on the drive. So it is something we're working on, and bear with us, and we'll try and answer more questions going forward. And thank you so much for all of those of you who did send through questions. So from all of us here at the Fireside Chat...
good night.
Yeah, good night.
Thanks very much.
And we will see you all tomorrow.
Morning on drive.
Yeah.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Love you lots.